Don, in your childhood, in your earliest memories, what were some of the darkest moments you remember?
You showed me love, but I didn't know how to love at all. It was all me, me, me.
Addiction says, no, you keep going. There is no such thing as stopping.
The only time I really thought about my wife when I was in Las Vegas, or even called her, is to want to know how the motel was doing. My life was engulfed in that total lifestyle that I was living. So really, I'd check on the kids, but I'm in another world. That's the only way I can say it, of living. It's not natural, no. But when you're possessed like I was, your life is completely involved in all these things. Down deep inside, the only time I hated myself really, when I would say, I would go home at night after I've done, gone for a week and done some things that were all wrong, all the things I talk about. The only thing I start hating myself indirectly is what when I'd lay down in bed at night and I'd say, try to reason out, why am I doing this? I really wanted to stop. I really did. But I didn't know how to stop. When your mind was so engrossed with all these things of the world, I can honestly say, I wish I could say and lie, but I cannot lie, because I knew nothing except the desires that satisfied myself, my own personal self. I don't think to this day my two kids really know how bad it was, even today.
Scene 49A, take one.
I grew up in the 1940s in a normal family. Well, you might call it abnormal because there was 14 of us. I happened to be the 11th child of the 12 children, our family was really close for the number of people.
Don is my uncle. My mom was a twin. Maude and Myrtle were the twins, and then they were down the ladder of the 12 kids, they were at the very bottom with Uncle Don below them, and then Uncle Merle was the baby.
My mother and dad were poor parents, and they would, on payday, if I remember, my dad would fight with my mother, and he'd pound his fist on the counter at the house, and he'd say, where'd the money go? Well, man, he was only making maybe $100 a week, and she'd making the house payment and paying the food and so forth, you know, and my mother would cry.
Don, in your childhood, there were certainly some difficulties. Can you explain a few of the difficulties you encountered?
When my mother and dad fought, I would retreat into my dark garage all by myself and do things that young kids do growing up.
Our identities get formed largely from the way that we're brought up, with the environments that we're around, the atmospheres that we're around.
It was just part of my insecurity. That was my place to retreat. I would hear my dad, you know, just saying, where'd the money go? Where'd the money go? So that was my part of why I was running to that garage. I was unhappy I was fearful my dad was going to hit my mother or so forth.
Childhood experiences can lead to adult behavior in most cases. It's called environmental influences.
I would run down to the grade school where I was raised and played basketball for a while, or I would run down to the pool room.
Say, for instance, a father is an alcoholic and the son witnesses him drinking every day, arguing with his wife, the child's mother. This is emotionally effective and destructive in a young person's upbringing.
My dad was such a good dad, but he didn't make that much money, but he built a little box on the wall to accumulate for Christmas so we kids would have some money at Christmas. When situations that my mother and dad would happen, the emotional part of me would stir up, and I would go and take a knife and take the box down off the wall and stick one of the knives in there and slide out the nickels and pennies so that I could run down to the pool room and play the pool. And I just kept on trying to get away from it, but it had already been planted in my life from my childhood or so forth.
1 out of 5 teenagers experience gambling-related problems. The fastest growing group of pathological gamblers in the United States today are high school and college students because of the credit cards that are so readily available to them and because of the internet.
I know that my gambling and my fear and all that insecurities, all these started at a particular age. Well, when I was shooting basketball and I was getting good, that was my outlet. That was my way of escaping away from my family situation. So I ran down there and played basketball. And I spent a lot of my time right on the little basketball court.
Don Reed, he's a couple years older than me, you know. But I always knew that he was a great athlete. Don was a star. I mean, Don he was a natural. He just walked out on that court and when he fired that ball up, it was gone. I mean, you know. It's just like people try to be something as hard as they can, but it never works. But he was just a natural.
I had already established a contract with the college at that particular time.
He went out for football, which he shouldn't have, and I'm still going to remind him about that because, man, we all were his fans. He went out and he hurt his knee, and of course, it slowed him down, and he was still good, but, you know, he hurt himself when he went out for football.
I was really looking for success in myself. I had visions of me now being a great basketball player because I loved the sports and I knew that I was really good.
When you're an athlete like that, it becomes your entire being. You eat, drink, and sleep being an athlete. The women that you're with, they're with you because you're an athlete, most of them. The friends you have are your friends because you're an athlete. So you're driven by that. You know, you eat, drink, and sleep it your whole life. I mean, I know Don was the same way as I was. We're all that way. We're from diapers up through junior high, through high school, through college. And, you know, I did make it to the NFL for several years. So I understand that process. It becomes you. It just consumes your life.
All my life was wrapped around sports. I had no desire except to make sure that Don Reed was making the top position or whatever it was at. It was strictly sports with my God.
If we're in a environment that is about me and driven about what can I get out of the situation, we're going to grow up and we're going to find that our identity is internal. It's self-focused and about me. What can I get? How do I do this? Because that's how what we've learned. And so when we're raised up without God in our lives, we find those types of things. And so if you have parents who have made their identities about themselves, if you have moms who are about their kids, if you have dads who are about their jobs, and they're using different things to try and say, this is who I am, you're going to grow up and find that, okay, what is it that I do well? Because that's now who I'm going to become. And that's going to become my identity.
After 2 years in college and my leg went completely bad, I did not want to stay at Westminster College because my basketball career actually was over and I didn't want to take a handout at the college. Now I'm still fighting the spirit of my childhood experiences, all the problems that I had, but my motivation now is shut down. I had failed as a basketball player because of my leg. It affected my baseball ability, my trial with the Pirates. Everything was falling. My whole empire was tumbling down.
I think that's what happened to both of us, and that's what happens with a lot of athletes. When you experience that, I don't know how to explain this in any other terms except this. It's like a death. Okay, you're an athlete your whole life, and that's all you know. You eat, drink, and sleep an athlete. People know you as being an athlete. But then if you suffer an injury, all of a sudden you go into this deep depression because you have identity loss. And that's what happened to Don.
So I left the college, And I turned around again and I went to the Army. And then my gambling, sex, and so forth started manifesting again when I went into the Army.
And I went through the same personal thing. I mean, I played, you know, about 3 years in the NFL, was rated the number one center in the entire country when I was in college, coming out my senior year. I mean, that was my life. That was who I was. And I had an injury, and that's what ended my career. And then after that, I just fell into deep depression and drug addiction and just the whole way. It's so similar to Don's story to me. It's unbelievable. But he went through the exact same things I did, and I went through what he went through. So I understand that one injury, you suffer the loss of your identity. And that's why people fall into that deep depression, or that you're trying to find who you really are. So you're running around with sex addiction or drug addiction or opioids now, and the whole drug problem of how bad it is. It's an epidemic. And that's why people are looking for it. If they're an athlete or not, they're looking for that peace that can only be found in Jesus.
When that identity gets stripped from you, something happens and that piece of you is now gone. You're now struggling because that piece of you is gone. It's not about I'm who I am because of something else. It was I am who I am because I've made me.
Before I went to the Army, I met my girlfriend, Donna, and she was sending me money during the time I was in the Army. I was losing my paycheck from paycheck to paycheck, going away for weekends, and she didn't know all the problems that I had with gambling at that particular time. I would leave the Army on weekends, and I would go in town on my leave, and I would gamble or drink the whole weekend in places, undesirable places. You met all kind of people, you could all kind of card games, but most of the time I was getting in undesirable lifestyles, you know, with the women and booze and so forth and the gambling.
The lottery, their slogan, a dollar and a dream. It used to be said, hey, this is a way to get out of the ghetto. Not anymore. They're selling hope now. This lottery, put your hope in this lottery. You see, you don't have to get an education. You don't have to work because we've come up with a game you can play and your problems are going to be over.
Donna came out to Colorado with her parents and that's where we got married. And you know, we found a house where the lady said if we took care of some dogs out there, we could have it rent free, and she gave us a car. And we was there one night at 6 o'clock at night, sitting in her house, which is about maybe 200 yards from the house where she let us have free. And all of a sudden there was an explosion. And we ran up, cleared up to the house to see, and it was engulfed completely in fire at the foot of Pike's Peak. And by the time the fire department got there, they didn't even attempt to save the house. And naturally, I sent Donna back to Pennsylvania here because we had no home to stay in. I served out the remaining time of my service. And then I went back home and lived with my wife at her parents in Greenville, Pennsylvania. Then the addiction of gambling and all the other addictions that went with it was actually increasing as I started living with her and her parents. And I did locate a job with a local accounting firm, and they in turn told me to go back to college. So I in turn went back to college to get my degree in accounting. Then we bought a home on Moorfield Road in Hermitage, Pennsylvania. I was drinking heavily at the time when my two children were being raised in my home on Moorfield Road in Hermitage, Pennsylvania.
What was that horrible emotion when you realized your dreams had been shattered?
There are over 10 million problem pathological gamblers right now in America. You know, gambling is seen as fun, unless you're looking through the eyes of an addict. Gambling is addictive, progressive, and dangerous.
I end up starting into an accounting practice with the name of Robert E. Mort, a company. And I worked there for 3 or 4 years. And everything was going real, real good. But in the meantime, I was still drinking and gambling. All these addictions were going on, pretty well hiding it from my wife, Donna.
I knew Don when I was very young, before he was a Christian. We lived in the neighborhood, and I had heard about him and to kind of keep away.
In the early days, it was good. He was a good father. He was a, father to many kids in the neighborhood, too.
Donna, I knew her about the same time, but I really got to be close to her when we moved next door to her.
All of a sudden, one year, I started to decide to go into my own business. And I turned around and built my business real good. I rented the places in Hermitage, Pennsylvania, and my business grew and grew. And at that particular time, I was taken out entertaining people at night, again, drinking, gambling, and all the addictions that I had.
Behavioral addictions really, whenever they get locked into us, and we can look at the idea of identity, behavioral addictions stem out of our need for identity. Who are we going to belong to? How are we going to belong to that group? And so behavioral addictions become that outgrowth. And sometimes people look at them and it's not a big deal. Maybe it's sports, but you've become obsessed with sports, but because it's not considered a taboo thing to do, nobody cares. Some things are more taboo, and some things are more destructive.
Don and Donna, they were like coming and going a lot. I could see through, we lived like across from them with my parents, and the wild parties and the late night parties. And it was a lot of commotion, lots of cars everywhere, and just lots of noise. And I was told, you know, not to go there as a child.
We had family reunions every year, and the men would always go to the bar, and the girls would stay with the kids at the pool, you know, and he was always looking for fun, looking for a good time. Always very charismatic, always wanting to be the life of the party.
I did not have a good relationship with my dad in those years. He was a great father, let me say that. He was a great father, gave us the best of everything. He took us on nice vacations.
Addictions, regardless of how masked they are or how easily seen they are, tear us down, destroy us, and they grow from those early ages of just saying, okay, who am I? And when I do this, it feels good. And the better that makes me feel, then the more that I'm going to do that thing.
The first time that I met Don and got to know him was when we visited at their house. Actually, it was through taxes. but Donna was there, and Donna I knew from high school. We both went to Hickory High, and she was 1 year behind me. But then Don kept stepping into the picture, and I heard some really tough things about him. And of course, Johnny and I, being born again Christians, we started praying for him and trying to bring him along.
My business just went so good, I decided one time, I was in an office right across the street from what they call a townhouse motel, and I looked at that motel from my office across the street, and I said, I'm gonna buy that motel. Well, in 1972, I bought that motel, and I moved my accounting practice then from the office across the street into the second floor of the motel. Now I get involved in more and more. I got involved not only in gambling, I got involved in a bar, a nightclub, and I had a contract with about 6 trucking companies in Hermitage, Pennsylvania. And as a result, my motel room was selling 30, 40, 50, 75 rooms a day, and what we called in my particular life, sort of to say, turnovers.
Things were going very well for a while. But the tavern life was really beginning of a big downfall, I believe, at that point in time.
My sons were bartending at an age of 10 or 12 or 14.
He had a nightclub up in Sharon, and I used to like to go there, and he'd step up and try to sing. I said, Don, you can't sing. He said, well, he would, you know, he was in the world, you know.
My business was just growing and growing, but my addiction to gambling on weekends, Donna was running my motel, she was running a real estate company, my kids were living one day at my home, the next day we were living in a motel, we were just like a bunch of vagabonds, my life. And my wife, Donna, did not really know how bad my gambling was at that particular time. I was running back and forth to these weekend poker games. A man came in one day and said, Don, I got some free tickets to go to Las Vegas. That was what I wanted. I wanted to go to Las Vegas, so I started lying to my wife. I said, well, I'm going to go out there and just see if we can do some business. First, I went on a junket, a junket, they pay your way out. You have to put up front money, which I did. And as a result, there was about 20 of us at that particular time flew right from Vienna, Ohio, right into Las Vegas. Well, that was the first time. I started going to Vegas all by myself. I did not need anybody to take me out in a junket because they knew that I had some money. I knew I had a motel. And as a result, I could go free. So they flew myself out and I went out there and I started going to Vegas three or four or five times. How many times they would take me, I didn't have to pay nothing, paid my room, and I started gambling heavily out there.
...20% of pathological gamblers attempt to commit suicide at least once in their life. If that many become addicted to it and 20% of them attempt suicide, what about your daughter or your son? How would you feel if it happened to them? So gambling is a problem for everyone.
Did you ever feel that at some point this lifestyle was going to catch up with you or come to an end? What would it take to get you to change?
People who are addicted to gambling, 62% of them will commit a crime. They will embezzle money, they will fraud, they will use theft, insurance fraud, 62%.
Things escalated during a period of time. That was helped by the fact that the economy made a downturn, business started going bad, the transportation industry stopped, the cash flow stopped into the business, which precipitated the chasing dollars here and there. The gambling escalated, the drinking escalated, the dark period escalated during that time. So it was in my age 16, 17 year period of time when that really happened.
I kept asking my wife to go to Las Vegas, but I didn't really want her to because I was satisfied the way I was going. But to pacify her, I kept asking her. Finally, she said she would go. So we arrived in Las Vegas, one of my flights that they paid my way out and back on. And we got in the motel, and of course, she went up and put the suitcase in the motel. And I, of course, went to the crap table, and I was playing blackjack and crap at the time.
How do I see my dad when he's at his worst? Well, do you have a week or two?
She came down to me and dressed in a beautiful outfit. She wanted to say, now you've been here for 4 hours. And she had went to the room and probably went swimming. And everything seemed pretty good. When she come to the table, she says, come on, honey, we're going to go to a floor show. The floor show was paid for. The booze was paid for. The food was paid for. So I said, no. I said, you go back upstairs and I'll be up in about 20 minutes.
He could be very mean. Very abusive verbally, not physically so much, but he could get pretty wound up. And the scary thing is you lived in fear, not knowing what's going to walk through the door. Is it going to be Don Reed or is it going to be the monster?
She called around finally. She said, get up here. I want to go out for supper. So I went upstairs there and walked into the room, and my personality just changed. I was down maybe $5,000, which would be an awful lot of money today.
He can flip on a dime, you know, whether he's got worries about the alcohol, or if he's drunk, or whether he's got worries about all the gambling he just lost, or the problems with his marriage. There's so many things that could just set him off that he would just not really be there with you mentally. His mind was somewhere else, and life around him would be like an inconvenience, you know?
I didn't want to leave the table, and she kept telling me, you know, that's going to go. I said, I don't want to go to a floor show. I'm going back down the table. She said, no, I want to go to the floor show. And I was so engulfed in the worldly filth that I was involved in, and she didn't know anything. And I grabbed her, by the neck. And I was choking her, but not going to kill her or anything like that. But I was emotionally wanting to get back to the table to finish or get even with what my debts I owed downstairs.
And what's a sucker want to do? He wants to get even. He says, the next time I bet, I'm going to get even. I know I'm going to get even. But the problem when you're a sucker, even if you get even or winner, you never quit. Because it's the high that gets the grip on you. And it takes money to keep the high going. And since it's addictive, progressive, and dangerous, when you start out making a small bet, it's addictive. So what happens? It gets progressive, because if you're betting $5 and $5 and $5, you get a little rush off of that. But now you're betting $50, and that's a little stretch for you. What happens? You get a little bit more of a rush. There's a little bit more excitement. The adrenaline's going a little bit stronger, and it progresses and it progresses. It keeps more money and more money to keep the high going until it becomes dangerous.
Finally, she let me go, and I went back downstairs and never got to take her to the show that I remember of.
I resented, at that time in my life, the father that I wanted but I couldn't have. And again, you got to bring my mom into this. My mother was the peacemaker.
My mother came back and she was just totally dismayed, because it was a totally negative experience for her.
I don't know how far I went to stop her, but I know one thing. I had to get back to that table. That's all I thought of. And she was just a beautiful wife wanting to spend a night with her husband.
No, I was not aware that my dad choked my mom. That's,
There's no way you can justify that when you have a beautiful wife that loves you and been with you and running your businesses and her business too, and finally get her to Las Vegas, and she's interrupting my lifestyle now, and I can't continue on doing what I want to do.
There's different ways that we can address the actions in our lives. We can find ourselves going after these actions in a compulsive way. And when we go after them in a compulsive way, there's still that need inside of us that's taking us to these places. But we have the ability to just say, you know what, forget it. I'm done with this thing. And when we can get a little more frustrated with it, and when we get to the frustration level, we let it go, and maybe we turn somewhere else or turn to a different thing that we think might be our solution. Addiction doesn't allow for that. Addiction says, no, you keep going. There is no such thing as stopping. And no matter how deep that pit gets, and no matter how far that hole goes, logic is gone. It's no longer about, does this make sense? The addiction says, you keep going, and nothing else matters. So even though I can logically look at things on paper, or I can logically think about things and say, okay, but every time I do this, bad things happen, or I keep losing at this game that I'm playing, the addiction says, it doesn't matter. You keep going until you win.
When I went back myself to Las Vegas, I was there one night, and all of a sudden I was gambling. I stood for 22 hours. I don't want to say this isn't very nice, but I couldn't go to the bathroom. I was gambling, captivated by that spirit of gambling. Prostitutes were walking around, women doing this and that. I stood throwing dice for 20 some hours. A man came one night after I had gambled 22 hours, and he said, Mr. Reed, he said, I was here yesterday, and you were here, and I went home and slept 8 hours, and I was here 8 hours, and I come here and you're still here 8 hours. He says, why don't you just go upstairs? He said, you still got credit here, and he showed me of around $25,000, which would be maybe worth $200,000 a day. And he said, you go upstairs and take a nap and clear up your head, come on down. He really almost was a compassion like an angel almost to me, but regardless, I went upstairs in that motel, and I looked in the mirror, and I thought to myself, well, okay, I'll take a 5-hour nap and I'll go back down. I went to a table and there was a Gideon Bible. When I took the Gideon Bible, all right, I turned around, took the Gideon Bible, looked at it, opened it up, and shut it up, set it down, and went to bed for 5 hours. But went back downstairs and started gambling for about 20 more hours. And that's when I lost all my credit, everything. I couldn't have no more cash, no more credit. Then I decided to go over and play another game they call Keno, where you see all the losers in Las Vegas, a form of bingo. I'm over there playing Keno on my last $5 because I already had my meals paid for before my plane took off to come back to Youngstown, Ohio.
They say that heroes are usually the most silent people. And the biggest hero in this whole story really is my mother. And I haven't cried in 20 years. The thing that she endured to keep the family together. I don't know how she did it. She put up a lot of crap. If he wasn't running around with 30 different women, if he wasn't losing $50,000 at the gambling table, if he didn't just go through 2/5 of liquor. You know, just to keep the family together. The biggest heroes are often the people that are most silent.
Donna, it wasn't me, it was something inside of me, hold of me, controlling me, that I had no conscience, no mind, no nothing, and I'm so sorry. So sorry what I did to you and my kids. And I just, your love, you showed me love, but I didn't know how to love at all. It was all me. Me. I'm just so sorry that I hurt you so much. And I love you. I do. So I come back to Hermitage, Pennsylvania. I owed Las Vegas the money. I said, I don't know what I'm going to do. I told my wife, she still didn't know anything about this. I said, look, I said, I'm not gambling. I owe all these banks. I'd signed my wife's name to I don't know how many loans at that particular time. And I owed Las Vegas about $20,000. At that time, I had built my accounting practice up pretty good because it was upstairs in the motel. I turned around and sold my accounting practice, which I had built, for $20,000. I gave $15,000 to Las Vegas on the 20 debt and kept $5,000. I started doing income tax returns down in the cellar of my home. I was at this particular time still gambling and doing all the things that was controlling me.
I think Don was at the point where Don was Don. He was the almighty king. He had a very successful business. Everybody liked Don, but then again, how many times do you hear everybody likes a drunk? And this is basically where Don was.
He owed many banks thousands of dollars. And I know that was not a good point in his life. And I know right then and there, the guy was broke.
C, take one.
Is it fair to say that you were at this point searching for something?
My wife had went to a prayer meeting. She come home one night and she said, hey Don, she says, guess what, I got saved. And of course, I didn't even know what saved meant. She said, if I get raptured here tonight, she said, you know, don't, you'll be missing me. I didn't know what raptured meant. I only thought what it meant rupture because I played basketball. That was what it meant to me.
When she finally gave up, she accepted the Lord as her Savior. And she started praying for my dad and had her friends in prayer circles.
One afternoon, I got down on my hands and knees after Donna got saved in Sharpsville, Pennsylvania, in a couch in my living room on November 22, 1974. I put down the bottle and picked up the Bible. And for the first time, I saw my two sons come down off the bus. And I said to my two kids, I said, your daddy's come home. And they come down the driveway and I hugged them both. And my wife came along and I told her that I got married, got saved too.
Knowing Don, you got to know his disposition. He was on the verge of breaking often, and because a lot of people were praying him in. He had no idea how many people were praying behind his back. And Johnny and I, we made him understand that. So did I see a crack in Don's life? Yes. And that crack was the Holy Spirit, of course, starting to work on him.
God gives us all second chances. And I'm thankful that I understand that you have to give someone a chance. You have to forgive. Just like my mother forgave and forgave and forgave and forgave and forgave.
I was not born an alcoholic. I was not born a compulsive gambler. And environmental has a lot to do with addiction today. A lot of people try to blame this or blame that. No, I knew I was doing wrong. No one had to tell me. But my wife and I went to that prayer meeting. They started praying behind my back. And as a result, November 22nd, 1974, in my living room, in that couch, the second time on my hands and knees, I got up off my hands and knees. And as a result, I started my Christian walk.
And he never gave up with studying the Bible, and he also never gave up trying to make up for his past with me and my brother and my mom. A lot of times said, boy, I'm sorry, I was such a, you know, piece of dirt.
I started telling people my testimony, and that was exactly the same day that God changed my life. And I haven't had a drink, gambled, adultery in 40 some years as I stand in front of you people here today and tell you that what gambling and alcohol and drug addiction and all these addictions, and I'm not just talking about drinking, gambling, sexual, I'm talking about all the addictions today that people are involved in.
There was a change that came not only gradually, I could see it with my taxes. Not that he did anything wrong. When we went in and talked to him, his first 15, 20 minutes was talking about the Lord. And so we knew Don had made it, and he was broken down and accepted and became a changed man.
You know, when you see someone being such an opposite kind of person, it was a little hard to believe, because you wonder how one person can do this and then the next minute be changed and, you know, be that person that's, you know, God and Christianity and everything. But as he starts speaking, and really, you can tell by the way he speaks that he believed it and he truly was reborn again. And I think the more people talk to him, they recognize that he wasn't, some of those people kind of fake it. And we knew this was I knew that it was an everlasting thing for him. And I was happy for him.
People had better think about it before they walk into a casino. You better give thought to your steps, because they are designed to turn people into addicts. There are no clocks, there are no windows. If you just go in to have dinner and see a show, you will walk through that casino on your way out, because there's no other way to leave. And you will see people looking like they're having a whole lot of fun. And if you're out there and just happen to be lonely and all of a sudden there's a bright lights and people laughing and all and you're lonely, you might sit down just because you don't want to be lonely anymore.
They repossessed my motel. I still owed all the creditors. And then one day, the Lord in the cellar of my home said, I don't want you to declare bankruptcy. And I went like, what'd you say? I'm only making $6,000 a year. And I owe many, many banks. I owe all these creditors. So I made a list of every one of these debts that I had. Put them down on a piece of paper and put down, I'll pay $5 a month here, $10 a month here on the banks.
Don came to a point where finally he said, basketball isn't my life. My business isn't my life. He just came to the point where he simply said, Jesus Christ is going to be my life. And that's where he took off.
At that time, I was just making $6,000 a year. And I'm raising two kids, a house payment, all these payments, and my accounting business started expanding so much. So I turned around and moved my accounting practice from the cellar of my home into Route 18 there.
I had heard about Don's past through the radio ministry he had and listened to interviews he was doing on that program and got to know him basically. And then, of course, being friends with his wife, we started hanging out more and I spent more time at their home. I saw his way of being with people that had been in that lifestyle. He would take them off the street, feed them, and share Jesus.
You really need to focus on the bad because nobody really will appreciate the good because they're complementary, they're mutually complementary. And unless you really understood where he was and what kind of a person he was, you can't fully appreciate what he is now.
For 2, 3, or 4 years, I was at that particular property, and one day another man walks in to me, a man who had a real estate company in Hermitage, Pennsylvania. He said, "We have somebody who would like to buy this property. Would you like to sell it?" I said, "How much?" He said, $400,000. And I said, "My wife, being in the real estate, I went to her," and she said, "No, we don't want to sell that. We'll just stay at our house." They come back a week later, and they said, "Well, how about $500,000?" And I said, "No," I said, "I can't want to, I paid $154,000. I said, "No," and they come back and said, "How about $600,000? Well, I said, "That's starting to look pretty good with all these debts I owed." So they come back, I said, "How about $615,000? That included the closing costs." They said, "Sold." So they went, I sold that property for $615,000. Just like God had told me down in the cellar of my home, don't declare bankruptcy. Years before, when I was operating my business out of the cellar of my home, I was cleared, as you know, almost $500,000 profit. Paid off all my creditors.
The contrast of after, when I became his neighbor, was there were lots of cars in his driveway again, but this time it was for Bible study. And there were lots of singing and praising. There was lots of good things. And I was always invited to go over and see what it was about. I could see a big change in their lifestyle. They were always together doing things and they were much more loving and the partying stopped. It was good partying.
Uncle Don has impacted my life by wanting me to share my Christianity with our family and everybody. He wants everybody to be saved. He has such a heart. Sometimes he can be a little straightforward and in your face, and people don't like that. I think that's one thing that in our family that sometimes bothered people. But I know his heart, and I know his heart is he wants everybody to be saved, especially his family. And he's, you know, just always been there whenever I needed to talk to him about anything. I know I could call him and talk to him. And I know he was thrilled to death when I called him the day that I said I got saved.
Donna, for many, many years, gave a lot of her life to Don, and Don gave himself back to her, and it was very evident. I think that them working together to get free of the debt that had caused, his past life had caused, and I was here for the mortgage burnings, and we had a big bonfire and just burned it all up because that was years of his past that he was setting fire to that night. And so many of us were just so encouraged. We had a prayer meeting at their home, and that was a very important time for them, and they were very close, and it was a wonderful relationship.
As you know, I got saved, I'm a Christian, and I'm sitting in my office one day. A man from down around Butler, Pennsylvania, comes to me and said, "Don, I have a television permit for a TV station in Hermitage, Pennsylvania, but we have to have $50,000 within a month." We got in contact with Russ Bixler, Russ and Norma Bixler from Wall, Pennsylvania. And you know what? When we did that, Russ said, "I'll tell you what, we'll buy the permit off you for $1. We'll buy it off you for a permit. We'll put the tower up and we will start what they call a channel, low powered station in Hermitage, Pennsylvania. We will start that channel and you can have free airtime for your taking care of the property up there." So now I'm going into the television business, free. When I was sitting in the cellar of my home, God gave me the name of the ministry called Crossing Paths. I wanted a name that didn't glorify Don Reed. And as a result, the name Crossing Paths come up. So Crossing Paths is now growing.
I met Don Reed through a friendship. A friend of mine is a friend of his, and he introduced me to Don. And a lot of the things in our lives were similar, us being both successful athletes and our backgrounds. And just really had interest in his life and the success and also failures of that. And he also needed some help in the television show that he does. And I committed myself to work with him and help him.
I've known Don for many years now through Crossing Paths Television. And he's kind of taken me under his wing. He's been a spiritual father to me and has taught me many things about what it means to have a relationship with Christ, the difference between a religion and truly living out your faith. And no doubt that my life has been changed through what Don has taught me.
Redemption is Don Reed. He's a prime example of somebody that's been taken from the gutter to glory. Don was an athlete for all those years and he never knew Jesus. So he was just running wild for all those years in his life. Then he had this phenomenal transformation, not for a month, not for a year, but over 40 years. This man has been serving God and living a life of integrity and truth, paying off old debts, paying off old bills, making old relationships right. I mean, his whole life has been transformed. Dalton Reed has a proven track record, and that's powerful. That's redemption. That's true change.
Did you have any other emotions that you can explain that maybe you've kept hidden in your own heart for some time?
One day, we was up in the mountains, and we were speaking up at Shiloh Ranch, and Donna fell walking down the hallway to our room, and we just thought it was an ordinary thing. And when she fell, she got up, and then one night she came back from selling real estate, she stumbled in my garage, and her eye got buffed up and everything, and we tried all the doctors in the area, and we went to Cleveland Clinic and walked in there, and they analyzed her, and they said she got Lou Gehrig disease. And that's something that we know is hard. She was the one that stuck with me. She asked me to buy her dog. She bought a little white dog. We trained the dog, and the dog would sit 5 foot from the bed. And after we would give her medicine, and the medicine was away, she would take the dog, and the dog would run and jump up on the bed with my wife. Donna was the hero of all this. She knew now what my gambling problem was, never brought it up. Brought paychecks home from the real estate business. Asked if she could have $10 out of it. And I was paying all my gambling debts when at the particular time. And she had a thing my son Doug developed. It was a laser red. It was a little pencil with a red end of it, red light on the end of it. And we developed an A through Z board. And she could talk to us through that I-W-A-N-T, breakfast, lunch, go to the bathroom, by moving her head. For a couple of years, I had to take her in the bathroom, hold her up while she took a shower. She in turn passed away December 22nd, 2005. And as a result, she passed away. And it was awful hard because she was praying for me. This is a woman that's a hero in my life. When she died, the little white dog we took away, the bed was still there. Everybody in my house saw this little dog sitting there, would not move. He said something, the dog, we called him Pookie.
was very much in love with Dawn, and she was saying how a lot of the past that has happened, she said she can just put it behind her because all of the people that Dawn had helped to get into heaven by coming to know Christ was worth it all. So she just like is so proud of him, and she was just so, I don't know, she just loved him.
If I could talk to my mom again right now and discuss the past, how did you do it? How did you, I can't fathom in this day and age with 50% divorce rate, how you weren't a statistic. I don't understand how you could have done it. And it just taught me love of a family that, you know, someone's got to be the binding glue. And she became the binding glue. So, and if I could talk to her again right now, I would say, Mom, I turned out fine. I'm all right. Because me and Dad have a great relationship now. I love my father more than anything. But again, if you understand the 180 degree nature of who he was then versus who he was now and who I saw him become over the years, things are different. So I'd tell her, we aren't fighting anymore, you know? So rest in peace, we're not fighting. He's a great guy. And he's more than made up from the past, in my eyes.
I had lots of memorable moments. They were always so giving and kind and very good neighbors. But I think I really, really became close to them when Donna was sick. And I was taking care of her, and I was in the home a lot. So I thought, I saw a lot of the caring and the love and the devotion that they had for one another and for other people, and how other people came and really helped out and, you know, just gave their time. And it was just a really good experience.
People ask me, have you been able to forgive your father? And I said, well, certainly, of course. You know, in the early days, it was kind of wait and see attitude, but yeah, certainly have forgiven him, sure.
Whenever we give our lives to Christ and we live the way that God has called us to, we learn that our identity isn't about the things that we do, and it's not about the things that we can accomplish or what other people think of us. Our identity is designed and based in who God says that we are. And God says, you're my child. And first and foremost, that's who you are.
Over the years, I got to spend a lot of time with Dawn, and just going out to eat with him, going out to lunch or wherever we go, I realized how big of an impact Dawn really made on the community. There's so many people who know him, so many people who have had their lives personally touched by his ministry and by his life, because they know who he used to be, they know what he came from, and they know what he's doing now. And no doubt, Dawn's sphere of influence is very, very broad.
During the 70s, it was very hard here in this community with jobs. My husband lost his job, so now he's unemployed. And so we started working with Don in a food pantry out of our house. And what Joe and Don would do is they drive into Cleveland every week and we pick up all kinds of food. And we fed every week probably about 150 to 300 families. Whoever came to the door, we fed them. And Don paid for the whole thing during that time.
What I am impressed with personally about Don's past is to see where God has brought him from. It's not the things that he necessarily has done in the depths of darkness, but it's where God has brought him from. And that's what's really touched my life, touched my wife's life, and the people around us, even at my ministry and my church. I mean, they all know Don, they all love Don. And to see that God can do that for Don Reed, he can do it for anybody. And that's a word of encouragement to us all.
Deception and lies, addictions will keep us from God's best in our life. Whether it's gambling, pornography, whatever that addiction is, it will keep us from stepping into all that God has for us. Jesus said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Anyone hears my voice, I will come in and sup with them and them with me. What he's saying is, whatever's going on inside of here, and if you're trying to deal with it under your own power, he was speaking to the church. He says, I will come in if you will open the door and be the very center of your life. I will help you fight the battle.
When you're in this journey, and I talked about how friends may disappoint you, and this is what Don talks about a lot, because he had relationships with people prior to that, where friends will let you down, family members will let you down, but see, Jesus will never let you down. He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. And see, that's the transition of Don Reed. That's what really wraps everything up. I mean, this was a man that had no real purpose. He was out of control. I was out of control. A lot of the athletes are out of control. A lot of people are out of control. But until we really had that transformation and had that personal relationship with Jesus, then we actually found our life. There's a scripture in the Bible that changed my life, and it says this: for those that try to gain their life, they'll lose it. But those that lose their life, for my name's sake, Jesus said, they're gonna find it. And that's it. That's what happened to Don. That's what happened to me. And that's the story of his life. That's how to sum it up.
Redemption means to me being restored back into full communion with God, being justified by what Christ did to me, that now there's no block between me and God. Now there's no death. Now the curse that came into the world in my life through sin is no longer has power.
There may be some here that are fighting a battle. You're struggling with an addiction, or there's something that you're trying to deal with that's keeping you from all that God has for you. I believe there's an anointing here that God will come in and by the power of the Holy Ghost, burn out any of the junk that needs to be burned out.